This is the Honky Tonk Man, the greatest intercontinental heavyweight champion of all time, and you're listening to the Gerweck Report podcast with Steve Gerweck and fabulous Frankie Dee.
Monday, October the 27th, 2014, I am Steve Gerweck, the webmaster of www.gerweck.net, your source on the World Wide Web for all your pro wrestling news since 1997. And as always, I'm joined along with my tag team partner, Frank Dee. What's up, Frank Dee?
Nothing much, man. Can't wait to get this one because I think the people are going to really enjoy it.
Yeah, because today it's a very special guest on the Gerweck Report podcast. He is the greatest intercontinental champion of all time, certainly a Hall of Famer at some point. And I've been trying to get this guy on for a long time, and today we finally hooked up with him. Honor and a pleasure to welcome the Honky Tonk Man. How you doing today, sir?
The greatest intercontinental champion of all time. I kept saying it and saying it, and finally WWE admitted it.
the greatest intercontinental heavyweight champion.
Yes, absolutely. That's like from these old interviews that we did with Mean Gene, and yes, the heavyweight champion. Put that in there. You know, it's one of those things where, you're right, you've tried to get me on the show for a long time. And back when I was doing my own podcast, I wouldn't do anyone else's because that's the old school style of me, that you don't promote anyone else's show when you're running your own. And prior to that, then, you know, the podcasts weren't as popular as they are now. They're extremely popular now. And I don't do mine anymore, so I'm open to do legitimate podcasts. And as we were talking before we went on air, I don't do the ones of the kids are down in mama's basement, and, you know, and they got all their porn films down there, and, you know, they got a podcast.
Well, first question would be is, kind of update us, what's going on with the Honky Tonk Man? I see you on your social media, your Twitter there. You're all over the country. You just worked a show with one of the Bushwhackers, and update us on what's going on with Honky Tonk Man out there.
Yeah, I did this thing where I was going to do a farewell tour for 2014, and a lot of people took it the wrong way. And you know, of course, Cher's been doing a farewell tour for the last 10 years, and Terry Funk's done multiple retirement shows. So I thought, well, gosh, this might be a little way to pick up some business, but it kind of backfired in a way. A lot of people think, well, he's retired, you're retired. But I do still want to transition out of actually getting back into the ring. Not that I don't like it. I do. I love the wrestling business, and I love performing in the ring. But it's to the point where, and I said this the other day to Bill Apter, the young kids coming along, they all want to be stuntmen and not wrestlers, and we're not stuntmen. The things that they want to try to do out there, and you know, I'm 60 years old now. I'm not going to skate on my age, but I don't ride the bicycle the same way they ride it, and I never learned to ride it upside down and doing flips and doing those things that they do. I learned to ride the bicycle one kind of a way, and it still works when you do it that way. You do it properly, you can still control people's emotions out there. But the facilities now, the rings are terrible. Going to some of these towns, and it's not good anymore. And that part of it, I don't want to go into the locker room and not be happy around these young kids because they deserve to see the veteran and you know, a happy side of the business.
You know, you were just saying you're 60 years old now and you're still active in the business. You're doing the tour currently. And how are you doing physically? I know you've had some injuries over the years. How's the body holding up?
So far, you know, I've been extremely fortunate. I've had whichever injury you always say is the worst one. But when you look back, I'm very fortunate that I've had no major operations at all, nothing. I've had stitches one time and kind of reattached my finger from a stupid stunt that had nothing to do with in-ring. But other than that, no, I've not, you know, broken bones maybe that I didn't know anything about that didn't keep me from performing. But other than that, it's just normal for someone in sports entertainment. And I like to call it sports entertainment. I don't care what people say about how fake or phony the wrestling business is. Listen, everything is fake and phony. Everything. The 5 o'clock news is fake and phony. But so I take issue with people that pick on the business that way. But we take a pounding like anyone else that's in any kind of a contact sport. We get a constant pounding.
Now, you were talking about, you know, possible retirement. You know, doing this retirement tour or whatever, close out 2014. When Honky Tonk Man hangs it up, is there an opponent you like to have, or how do you see yourself exiting out of the actual in-ring action?
You know, you never look at it that way. I never have thought about it like who would be my last opponent or the guy that I said, this is the last match and I want to have it. First of all, I don't know who would promote it the right way, and I don't. I'm not a promoter at all. I'm a self-promoter. I promote myself. But I wouldn't know. And when that time comes, you'll know when. The thing is, you'll know when it's time to. When you go out there and you just cannot do it anymore, and the fans look at you and shake their head, and they see this old shriveled up man that still can't do anything except walk around and yell or whatever they do. That's when it's time. As long as I get a good opponent out there and a good kid, I can still put on a 15, 20, 30-minute match and entertain the crowd. But it's hard to find those good kids anymore.
You know, you were talking up there a minute ago, Honky, about, you know, shriveled up old man, and two people come to mind when I think about that.
Ric Flair.
Yeah, well, you said it, not me. You said it about Dick Flair. And then the other one is Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, you know, I was going to talk a little bit about Hulk because we were at the New York Comic Con a couple weekends ago. And I didn't finish the question you had asked me about what I do. I try to do the Comic Cons now I'm trying to get into the comedy stuff and do so. I've done a few of these little comedy things where it's more or less a Q&A, and the fans like that. And that kind of a stuff, motivational speaking, I would love to train kids, but there's no place to take them and train them now and do that because WWE has the big training facility, and you have hundreds of kids down there, and I don't know what they do. But Hogan, you know, it's amazing, the power of WWE TV. He was in TNA, and I have a photo that I use of myself and Hogan together. When he was in TNA, I stopped carrying the photo around. People said, I said, what about Hogan? No, we don't like him. He's horrible. And so I stopped carrying the photo around for a couple of years. He gets back on WWE TV. Bingo. That's a hot seller, man. It's amazing that when he would do an autograph signing for TNA, there'd be 100, 150 people lined up. He goes over to New York Comic Con or Montreal Comic Con or Toronto, hundreds thousands lined up. That is the difference of just being from one show to the other.
So, in saying that, is there a specific reason as to why the Honky Tonk Man didn't go down there to that fledgling TNA brand?
Oh, gosh, I would never have gone. I would never have gone there, period. That was not ever something that even crossed my mind, ever. Jimmy Hart and Dutch Mantel called me once and asked me to come down and I said, well, what's the end result? Well, you know, we just got to use you one time and do this thing and get this guy over on TV. I said, well, first of all, I said, what does it pay? Oh, it's $1,500. I said, I'm not interested. I'm not interested. And they didn't bother call me back ever again. So it just wasn't it was a terrible product. It's still a terrible product. Not that the wrestlers are bad. For some reason, they have no way to promote the company, to go out and run a house show and fly in 20, 30 people and have 300 in the audience and maybe only 100 of them paid. It's just an independent television, it's an independent wrestling show that happens to be on TV.
Yeah, I think you're being nice with that one, Honky, because we've had pictures of Gerweck.net of there being 70 people in the audience.
I know. It was something. Listen, I was a WWE guy, and when I went to WCW, it was simple. I would have been a WWE guy, no matter what. And we went in there as WWE guys, and everyone that came over was WWE guys. And the sad thing is now, all the WCW guys that were down there, they're all the agents and, well, they call them producers now. They're all the guys working behind the scenes at WWE. And all the WWE guys are gone, not even in the company anymore.
What's your thought? You were talking about TNA. What's your thought currently on the WWE product? Do you watch it much anymore?
No, I but listen, if you don't work for the company, if I was a truck driver and I didn't drive for UPS anymore and I was driving for FedEx, I wouldn't care what UPS does. I wouldn't even look at their trucks. I wouldn't even care what the – what I do is totally different from what WWE does. It's called professional wrestling, but what I do on the weekends and where I go is not the same. And I don't want to watch their product because I don't want to try to make myself do what they do or go out and really compare these small independent shows that I do across the North America and feel bad that I'm not in a big arena with a lot of lights, a lot of smoke, and a sound system that works. It wouldn't be fair. It wouldn't be fair to get on a plane, fly somewhere, take someone's money, and then downgrade their product because it's not as good as the one on television. And what they do, I really don't care. I read the news reports, of course. I go on you guys' website. I was just on before you called me to catch up on legitimate news is what's going on because I'm still in the business and I need to know. But as far as their guys that they have and who's their champions and things, I have no idea.
Is there like a current favorite wrestler you have today? Is there anybody that kind of reminds you a little bit of the old Honky Tonk Man from back in the day?
Not really that, but every time I mention someone, they get fired or get in trouble or get put in the doghouse or get laid off, so I reserve judgment on that other than, you know, Randy Orton is probably the best talent they have there, and he has been for a long time, and please, Randy, don't get in trouble because I said that. But and the other kids, they all work really hard, and they're great kids, but there's something wrong that there's so many guys there, and they run so many girls and guys through. No one is catching on. No one is really taking that spotlight from John Cena.
What is your overall, opinion, Honky, about just the entire state of the business? You know, WWE right now isn't hot. TNA is on their way out. Ring of Honor, nobody really watches it because they don't get it. I mean, if you were actively, you know, in the business, like say at the WWE, what are some of the changes that you would implement to make the product better?
But it's so hard because it's a television product now. And you mentioned TNA. I was going to say, are they still in business?
For the most part, they are. But they're we call them the dead brand on this show.
Well, Ring of Honor, they have some great guys. Some good guys have come out of the Ring of Honor. They do things different. It's Ring of Honor would be like having a AAA show, a Mexican show, come in and be there featured on television or featured across these arenas. That if you're not in the right demographics, then of course their show, the AAA show, has never worked in America so much because of that. The Ring of Honor show is so different. It would be like years ago when we would all go to Japan or see Japanese style wrestling, and it was totally different from what we did in the States. And when you went there, it was hard for the American boys to adjust. And Ring of Honor it's a whole different style of wrestling than what they do. WWE, it's a fast moving television show. They are so ratings driven, you can't have time for a guy to go out and do a legitimate interview, and they don't want to have real personal issues because maybe it's a publicly traded company now, and you can't be cutting edge or you can't do the things and that we did our era of guys drew bigger crowds consistently for a longer period of time. If you could get those guys and put them on TV, first of all, with WWE, I would stop the soap opera-style backstage interviews where you do a cutaway and the guy's standing there still looking up in the sky like, oh, what happened? To me, that's the soap opera stuff that's on every day of the week. And when you get writers that write that kind of a way, it doesn't look right. It looks phony. It looks really phony. And we need some kind of realism back in the business somewhere.
And I guess this would be a good question to you, Honky. What is your current relationship with the WWE right now, and do you have the WWE Network for just $9.99 a month.
I'll answer the second. I think my laugh answered both of those questions, but the second one is absolutely not. I have never in my life bought a pay-per-view. Never in my life would I pay $9.95 or $9.99, which that number, that price is going to go up. I've said that. It's definitely going up. And I wouldn't do it. I mean, why? I mean, it just doesn't interest me to pay money to watch it. And now with the Internet, you can get up-to-date reports right away. It's instantaneous. You know what's going on in every match. You don't have to really see it. You can read it. I have good visualization. I can visualize. And as far as the relationship with them, who knows? I mean, sometimes it's okay. They call me once last year about the Nashville Raw and said, are you available for Monday coming up? I said, sure. Okay, we'll call you back. Never heard another word. But I talked to Bret Hart about it, and I said, yeah, it's funny, man. Do they ever do this? He said, yeah, they call me sometimes once, twice, three times, and then never call back. I said, well, it was kind of strange. You say, yeah, you're available. Okay, we'll call you back. You don't hear from them. So what kind of relationship? I don't know. I know that for some reason, obviously, when you said business was down a little bit, maybe, when business gets down, they start then to bother the independent shows. They start to bother the things we do out here as the senior citizens of WWE. When I say bother us, like sending out little notices to a promoter that he can't use a certain name or he can't use this picture for advertising, instead of sending it to me and letting me contact the promoter or letting me fix it, they go and do some sneaky little stuff that then scares the hell out of the local promoter. I mean, these guys get deathly scared, and they're ready to, you know, cut you loose. And now I don't get a payday. I don't get to go out and do what I do. And you go 20 years and they never bother you, and then all of a sudden they start again. Then this five-year break, they don't bother you, and the business gets bad, now they want to bother you again. And they're selective in their bothering of people, very selective. And that's what kind of set me off a few weeks ago about this. I have a trademark. My name is trademarked. My likeness is trademarked. They have right of use. They can use it anytime in any way they want. But it's mine. I own it. The name belongs to me. But to say that to a promoter, and sometimes the promoters aren't legally smart. They'll see that you're using copyrighted material on your ad, and you can't use that. It belongs to WWE. Then the promoter calls, oh, gosh, they're going to sue me. I have to pull the ads down. I don't know if I'm going to have to cancel you or what. Okay, what did it say? Send me a copy of it so I can see it. Most of the time, it's only happened a couple of times, but it's been over the photo. That the whoever they are, the promoter, will use that photo. It's the same as you guys. If you promote on your website and through that WWE photo up there that I'm going to be on your podcast, they might call and say, okay, pull that photo down. Oh, and here's the deal. The photos do belong to WWE. They own that. And that's a copyright. It's not a trademark. Names are trademarked. Writings and things of that nature are copyrighted. Photos are copyrighted. And WWE owns every photo that was ever taken by anyone who worked for that company.
That's very, very, very interesting. Other than the trademark issue that you have with the WWE contacting you about that, would you say...
they don't ever contact me about it. That's the thing.
They don't ever contact me.
Huh. They won't ever call me and say, look, you know, tell these guys don't use that photo. Okay, fine, I will. But don't sneak behind my back. And then there's other guys that use the photos. Tons of guys that's out there floating around. But if that's all that a legal department has to do is go out and bother with Honky Tonk Man, then it's a sad state of affairs up there.
Oh, it is. I mean, what did they say, Steve, earlier this year? They had to wipe, you know, $40 million from the budget?
Something like that.
Okay, now, who are they cutting? Well, they cut the $100 off for everyone's, we used to call them job guys, enhancement or extras, they call them.
Yep,
so you're going to take $100 away from them guys. That's really going to save a lot of money. Hey, why don't we take the private jet away? Why don't we take some first-class seats away? Come on. That's not how you save money, by chopping away at something like that.
Yeah, they've sunk a lot of money in this network. I mean, they're all in on it. They want you to pay the $9.99, or I guess you can get a month without the 6-month commitment for $12.99. To me, Honky, they're all in on this network, and if this network flourishes, I mean, this is great. And if it fails, I think we'll see more and more people lose their job at WWE.
I really can't see how it will work. It does not have the consistent viewership that NFL or NBA or Major League Baseball has. We're not in that category. And for some reason, I got my hats off to Vince McMahon and WWE. Vince will go out and take a chance. He will roll the dice that a lot of people will not do. And when he's successful at it, he's very successful. Has he had failures? Of course. Some of them have been of huge magnitudes that other people would have folded up and left the business over. He's a maverick. He does those. He's a man of vision. You can't take any of that stuff away. I don't see a number of 10, 15, 20 million people consistently buying that show for $9.99 or whatever. And if they increase it to $14.99, $15.99, $19.99, then you're going to see a huge drop.
Well, I think one of the biggest problems, and, you know, we talk about this all the time here on the show, is one of the biggest problems is that it's just not consistent with the content that they put on the network. I'm an old-school fan. Steve's an old-school fan. There are lots of old-school fans out there. And you go into the archives there, there's no wrestling challenge. There's no, you know, WWF superstars. None of that stuff is on there. And that's pretty much, I think, one of the big problems is the lack of content. Like, if I wanted to go on there and watch, you know, Honky Tonk Man, say, your debut, I can't find it. But I can go on YouTube and find it for free.
Okay, I'll tell you why. And this is something that, if you guys think back to the original Hall of Fame when it started, it did so success. I mean, they had it in a small building, what, 2,500 tickets sold or 5,000 tickets and for the first few Hall of Fames. And then as it started to grow a little bit, people were talking about it. There's a good buzz on. WWE does not like to, they do not like to recognize too much of their history. The only reason they're doing it now is because of the network. The only reason they did it just before the network and a few years before was for the Hall of Fame stuff. Remember now, the Hall of Fame went away for a long time. They didn't have it. And the reason they didn't have it was because they were going through this attitude era, and they did not want us guys to be associated with the new product. They don't want their guys to be compared to the Bruno Sammartinos. That's why Hogan's not on Raw every Monday night now, because they don't want to consistently throw him out there on Raw every Monday night for the people to go, gosh, that's Hulk Hogan. He's back. He was a big star. He's a bigger star than anybody. They have. And that's why the network, you're probably not getting a lot of legend stuff on it. I'm surprised they did the Legends House. I'm not surprised they did it. I'm surprised that they did it to 1 year, and it did so good for them ratings-wise, but now they're not sure if they want to do it again, simply because it did good in the ratings, and people are going, gosh, that guy was on the Legends House. Gosh, you're one of the legends. So they're not buzzing about some kids that they're bringing up out of NXT somewhere.
I think it says a lot when they offer their pay-per-views, which were usually $50 a piece, live on their network for $9.99. I mean, the product has really fallen off.
Well, there again, I'm just saying that because you can have a WrestleMania and you can fill up the 75,000, 80,000 seats and you can have 10 million people around the world buy it, doesn't mean you're going to consistently have 10, 15, 20 million people on a weekly or a monthly basis pay that $9.95. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm way out in left field. I just can't see it. But mind you, you're talking to a guy who 40 years ago, when they said, yeah, Ted Turner's got pay TV, he's got cable, and people are going to buy it. I said, no one's going to buy television. We get it for free. Well, I was wrong on that one.
Well, you know, Frank Dee and I have talked a lot about the network on this podcast, and I just think, as you were saying before, with the content is the major issue we have you know, Frank said, WWF superstars, the Vince McMahon and the Jesse Ventura years, the Wrestling Challenge, the Primetime Wrestling. I mean, shows that I grew up watching just aren't there. And to me, I'm thinking about networks that took 2 years to launch. They were ready to go in 2012, and here we are in 2014, and the core material that I grew up watching, the classic stuff, still is missing from the network.
See, and I haven't seen it, and I don't know what the lineup is on a week-to-week or day-to-day or whatever the basis is. It's hard for me to make judgment. I'm making a broad-stroke judgment, let's put it that way. Not to be politically correct in any way, but for all the fans out there who say I'm a grumpy old man and things of that nature, that's not true. You ask me a question, and I try to give you the answer that I would give, which would be I unless they put all the content and show the people as much as they can show them. You can draw people when you have a book doesn't sell if the book is only about one character. One character will not sell a book. A book has to have multiple characters, it has multiple scenes in it, it has multiple chapters, and that wrestling in a television show has to be that way. Sure, you gotta have midgets, you gotta have girls, you gotta have giants. Sheiks, as Freddie Blassie would say, sheiks, freaks, and geeks. Throw it all out there. Let them have it all. Don't keep it in the archives. Watch your archive it if you're not going to show it to them.
Well, I think, too, Honky, they don't show some of that older stuff because it makes today's product look pretty poor. I mean,
that's the point I was making about the Hall of Fame, and then the Hall of Fame came back because, gosh, well, if you sell 15,000 tickets to the Hall of Fame the night before the night before WrestleMania, you might as well sell 15,000 tickets.
True.
But if the Hall of Fame was only drawing 2,500, 3,000 people, you'd never see that Hall of Fame again. I can promise you that.
Well, speaking of the Hall of Fame here, and I don't want to be cliche.
No, I'm not going in there.
Well, okay, that's cool.
No, but, go ahead. No, go ahead. It's your show. You ask the questions.
Well, I mean, I don't want to be like every other show you've been on. It's like, well, you know, Honky, if they actually go in there, and I don't want to do that. Well, I want to ask.
Well, they already have asked, and I already had to say no once.
Really? But why do you think, though, that guys from your generation, and I'm going to bring up a couple in particular here, Rick Rude, okay, Davey Boy Smith, why do you think that they are not in the Hall of Fame?
Oh, and what you want to say, and Jake Roberts is.
I was going to say Coco, but you got it.
It's funny how I can read you guys' mind, and you know, it's there again. It's such a selective issue with how they do it, and it's not a they. It's actually one or two people that sit down, or now it's like maybe three, because there's the chairman and his next in line, and then his. You know, whoever's at the same dinner table. So that's how it goes. That's how it works. And it's all. And I think they let personal issues come into it, as opposed to what's good for the fans. What would sell a ticket? What do we need that's going to make this show really pop this year? And it's difficult to make those choices when there is a lot of people out there that have not ever been chosen or considered. And Rick Rude obviously is one. It's difficult to put people who have passed away in because the audience wants to see a live performer, I think. I really do. Not to say that you should not put someone in that's passed away. But it's more of a difficult task because then, as the years go on, who then would you use to induct that person? Well, let's use the next guy we're going to push that never even met the guy. So that's the thing. And when they asked me to induct Coco that year, I jumped at the chance because I said, sure, because it's a great honor for him. And then they said, do you need us to write a script for you? They obviously didn't know anything about Coco and my history together.
Yeah.
I said, I don't need a script. I've known a guy. We started together. We trained each other. I've known him for 37 years. Well, can you get it all done in 3 minutes? I said, of course I can. You know, it's such a nonsense thing. It's not, you know, I watch the National Football League Hall of Fame, and I'll watch the Baseball Hall of Fame, and the NBA Hall of Fame, even the Hockey Hall of Fame. because those are legitimate shows and things. But there again, when you say legitimate, is the Hall of Fame of any place legitimate? Well, this guy's going in. He took steroids and hit the ball further than anybody else. But this guy can't go in because he placed a few bets and made some money.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now, so that's where I look, how I see it. When I told you everything's fake and phony, it really is.
Well, and I guess my next question is going to be for you is, and maybe you can, you know, shed some light on this, because I don't know, Steve doesn't know, nobody knows, trust me, I've Googled it all over the place, and I can't find an answer to it. What do you think is the reason for the Macho Man Randy Savage not being in the WWE Hall of Fame, and what is the backstory, if you know, between him and Vince McMahon? I mean, what happened there?
I have no idea, and I have been around Lanny on several occasions, and personally, I wouldn't, and even business-wise, unless Lanny wanted to tell me, I wouldn't ask, because I've known him for 37 years, and first of all, it's really, he might tell me it's none of my business, and that would be true. Why, I have no idea, none whatsoever. There's been multiple rumors out there that nothing has been substantiated until Lanny comes forward and says what the real reason was or is, then none of us will ever know.
Yeah, Lanny has stated that he's had, you know, that Randy had a problem with the Von Erich family, the whole family getting put into the Hall of Fame, and he says, well, if the Von Erich family can be inducted into the Hall of Fame, then the Popple family can go in there too, and never put me in there. If something were to happen to me, never put me in there unless all three of us go in. That means the father, himself, and Lanny.
I mean, yeah, that's, you know, I've heard those things also, but now I've read something a few days or a week or so ago that Lanny is open to, well, if they wanted to put the Macho Man in, let's let them do what they want and be done with it however they want to do it, which is going against what Randy wanted. But as Lanny states now, Lanny is now in charge of everything because Randy's not around and Angelo is not around and the mother's not in well health. And it's up to him to make those decisions, and which it rightfully should be. And whatever decision he makes, I'll stand with him because, you know, I like Randy and Lanny very much. I put them both in huge high regard.
Well, that's funny you say that. Lanny is in charge of the estate. I thought Macho Man was married at the time of his death.
They had a prenup on all that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, because of what had happened with
Elizabeth,
with Leah's situation.
Yeah. Okay.
Which, I don't have one, and my wife's Canadian, so she could run across the border and leave me down here in the desert, you know.
Yeah.
Can you talk about the circumstances when they approached you about the Hall of Fame and exactly why you turned them down?
There were two issues, first and foremost, I had signed. I think I had 12 shows. I had signed 12 different contracts with Wizard World, the Comic-Con people, who ironically, you guys are going to love this, Wizard World won't use any of us independent guys now because they are in bed with WWE talent only.
Wow.
Yeah, so anyway, I had to... John Laurinaitis calls me about it, and I told him, I said, look, I have this deal with Wizard, and I just signed for 12 shows with them. They're huge shows. I can just make a lot more money doing this than, you know, 12 of these 60 or 70,000 people every weekend, and, you know, I can pretty much do about 10% of the gate of when people walk in. So you're looking $6,000, $7,000, $8,000. The Hall of Fame wasn't offering that kind of money, I can tell you that. So, but anyway, and he said, well, you can cancel those guys. They'll understand. I said, well, if I was on contract with you, would you let me go work for them? Well, of course not. I said, well, Johnny doesn't work that way with me anymore. And second of all, he says, well, it's your hometown, man. It's Phoenix and everything, and you're right there. You can drive over. All right, John. First of all, Phoenix is not hometown to just about anybody. No, and it's not too many people that were born out here. They all come from somewhere else. So saying it's my hometown, that doesn't move my bowels at all. But to tell me I could drive over there was an insult. That's an insult. I'm not driving anywhere. I don't even drive to the airport now. I don't drive. I'm not going to drive across town for them guys and be there for 4 days, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Oh, I'm sorry, 5 days, Monday. 5 days. When I could fly up, and I did, I flew up to Toronto. I got in there on a Friday morning. I did the Wizard World Friday night, Saturday night, and Sunday. Flew home on Monday morning and made about five times the money they were offering me. I mean, it's not about ego. It's not about that. Sure, would I like to have that ring? Of course. Maybe I'd do what Superstar Graham did. Get 15 grand for it. But I'm not ego-driven. I'm driven to make money. I'm driven to do things that provide for my family. And I'm sure, would the end result have been better? Maybe. Would they have put me in a DVD? Would they have done a book deal for me or something like that? Who knows? That's all maybe. Maybes don't work. You know, it doesn't work for me. You play ball with them, I try to, and then they send dirty letters to promoters saying they can't use my photos. So, I don't know. That's how I feel about it.
Well, and that's a perfect segue, because of something you just mentioned a minute ago. You said that you were on the phone with Johnny Ass there, and he
said that, and I didn't.
Oh yeah, I said
Johnny,
that.
Johnny was always great to me. I enjoyed him being my adversary. I miss him now.
Yeah.
I told him that. I said I miss arguing with you all the time.
Yeah. Well, Johnny Ace, Mr. Laurinaitis. You know, you mentioned there that he said you asked him, "Well, you guys let me work and do this other deal, whatever," and he said no. How does WWE get away with that when you guys are independent contractors? I mean, how do they hold you exclusive to that brand, and you can't do anything else, but yet they don't want to pay you for all these other things or give you any type of health benefits or anything?
Well, that was an issue before. It's not so much now. And going back to that Hall of Fame thing, that particular time and before that, now they have since changed it. But if I had signed to do that Hall of Fame in Phoenix, there was, at that point in time, there was a 90-day no-compete. So for the little bit of minuscule money they were offering me to drive over to the WrestleMania and have a big weekend with my family, like they really care, that little minuscule of money, if I had jumped at the chance and signed it, for the next 90 days I could not have worked in the wrestling business. So I would have given up. I would have given up now, and you guys are mathematicians, 3 months of pay, or however many weekends it is, and 90 days, that much weekend work for one payday from them, which was minuscule. When I say, and it is true, and if they ever come to me with that offer again, that they don't even, I'll just tell them, I'll put it out there publicly. Don't even bother calling me with that number. You better put some more zeros on it.
Well, they can't afford you right now, Honky. I mean, yeah, Vince has
so I guess I won't be going in.
Yeah.
but now since you know, I kind of made that public about the 90-day stuff, that particular after this happened, they since have changed that. You can do whatever you want. They even let guys piggyback now. I know that a whole bunch of guys that came down for New Orleans, they were over doing the WrestleCon wrestling signings, and they had other events around town that were non-WWE events. Will that continue? Probably not. I don't think WWE is going to let they're going to fly you in. You're going to be their guest at WrestleMania as one of their former, one of their Hall of Famers, and you're out doing WrestleCon and you're doing signings for high spots and people like that. No, I don't think that's going to happen.
But if they're offering, you know, such a little amount of money, I mean, you gotta. I mean, you're still, you know, at the end of the day, you're still a name in a business. You know, I don't understand why. I mean, all that stuff to me just seems petty. You know, it's just like trademark issues and copyrights and not having the rights to music and all that stupid stuff. It just seems really ignorant to me.
I know. And unless it happened to you, and it went down the way that it would go down, that you could tell someone how they were trying to put the old Steely Dan to you. The thing is, and I know a lot of you would say it, and my wife even says it, and sometimes, and you know, don't be so hard-headed, don't be so stubborn, don't be such an asshole about this. But look what happened. Look at the baseball players. It took those guys forever to start getting money off of skybox seats and to get for them not to use their. Look at the college players. That the images has now been used for video games. And people made millions of dollars off of these kids. And they finally, they're coming around and saying, okay, you can't use these guys' images and not pay them anymore. And that's why it sounds petty and everything, but it is. And if I have a trademark and I paid for it, WWE will vigorously protect their trademarks. And I'm going to do the same thing.
Oh, that's what I meant by it being ignorant. I mean, it's ignorant on the part of WWE. It's a huge, you know, a huge company here, and you know, I mean, my God, they own the video, they own your likeness and all this other stuff. They at least pay the money. I mean, that's what I mean by it's ignorant. It's like just like a lot of the stuff on the network is they don't want to some footage they won't pay the royalties to the artists to play the music, so it messes up the whole thing.
I know, and you know, when you look at it that way, and I look at it the same way too. Now here's a company; they got multiple limousines up there at the office that drive people around on a daily basis. You got the private jets that they fly around the country on, and I understand that you when you have to do big time business, you need to get from point A to point B very rapidly. But then to be argumentative over, you know, a $500, you're going to shut me off from working anywhere over because I might go out on a weekend and make $500, $300? Come on, man. You're right. It's real petty. But they play hardball, and if you don't play hardball, you're not going to play. You're not even going to be in the game. If you step back and say, oh, I'm just not going to say anything, well, good for you. Good for you. And really, you're right. It should not be that way. But Major League Baseball does it. Pro football does it. Hollywood movies, they all do it. It's like, okay, how can we cut a penny so small that we can keep the biggest portion?
You know, I think at some point, Honky, and I understand, you know, what you're saying, a weekend you're losing money on to do, what, five nights, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and then, of course, do the Raw, wherever it is the next night. But at some point, do you owe it to your fans, maybe, to take the ring, take the plaque, go up there on the big stage and accept the honors that you truly deserve to be in the Hall of Fame?
You know, if you look at it that way, that's you're getting to the sentimental side. If you look at it sentimentally, on the sentiment, then of course. But there, and I'll use Superstar Graham again, because Billy, he said this. He said there's nothing in the wrestling business that he has sentimental value to. Since all guys have gone out. I mean, they sell their boots, they sell their tights, they sell off all these things. And why? Because there's value in them. And if the fans are willing to pay that, if the fans are willing to pay me for the Hall of Fame, then I would do it. But it's WWE that channels the money, not the fans. There's a difference.
True.
If I could put my Hall of Fame on eBay and say, for every vote, you guys send me a dollar, and if I got $10,000, then I'd go do it. But to have it funneled through to WWE, then the money would be greatly reduced. So that's the thing where, listen, if they're going to make money, I want to make it too. And it's only fair.
Yeah, because it's all about, at the end of the day, it's all about you guys. And
as Frankie D said, it's such a big company, Forbes 500 company, there's enough to go around for everyone.
Yep.
And see, here's another thing. You go into a show somewhere, you go there, here's one guy, he negotiated, and you don't get what you deserve in any business. You get what you negotiate. One guy comes in, he don't really negotiate at all, but they throw him $300,000 for Hall of Fame. The other guy, he's $5,000. Now, is there $300,000 worth of difference between someone? I know old Hogan got ruffled a little bit when he found out Stallone got so much money just to come in and do 3-minute speech for him.
Didn't know that story.
He was a little bit miffed on that one.
The politics of WWE Hall of Fame.
and it shouldn't be. It should be a great honor, and everybody have a good time. But it's there again. It is what it is, and I wish it wasn't, but it is, and it's only gotten worse. Because now guys are looking at it like, hey, we're as big as NFL stars. You know, I won't they're like, woo, Ric Flair. Hey, I want $15,000 for 2-hour autograph signing. Well, if people are willing to pay it, Venture doesn't pay him that kind of money.
Well, Honky, do you think that Rick could get $40,000, or, you know, could he get $40,000 for autograph signing, or no?
He could probably use it, because I think that was something that was going on with the lawsuit over that belt, where he had taken some money or something. And the belt was not, the belt was, had been given to about 4 different people. I don't know. That's Rick for you. You know, I hope he gets his life together. He's not a bad guy. He's was caught up for so many years in Ric Flair. And sometimes, you know, there's one thing about the Honky Tonk Man. I do, when I walk around my neighborhood, I don't have a jumpsuit on and my hair dog black. And look, man, come on. I'm not styling and profiling when I walk to the mailbox.
Well, that's good to know that you didn't style and profile yourself in a bankruptcy like Mr. Flair.
Well, I scratch shit with the chickens, brother. I'll take whatever's out there. I don't care. If it's fair and I make the deal, it's like buying a car. Everyone says I got a good deal. Well, I used to sell cars. A good deal is like beauty. It's in the eye of the beholder. It really is. What's a good deal to someone might not be a good deal to someone else.
Very, very true.
So that's how I run my life. I do all my bookings myself. I always have. Everything goes through me. And if I don't want to take a booking, I don't take it. And if a guy plays around with a plane ticket on some goofy-ass airline that I've told them do not book that ticket, call me first. Let me see it. If they do that, will I miss a show? Probably. Especially when I had a guy last year that booked one on Frontier, and I said, don't do it. Frontier's horrible out here in Phoenix. And he did it anyway. And I get to the airport, 9 o'clock in the morning. The flight's canceled till 3 in the afternoon. Going through Denver, I could not have gotten to Chicago. I asked him to bring me in a day early for $35. He could have paid $35 for a hotel room. I'd have been there on Friday. Not stuck in the airport on Saturday. He says, well, man, can you go to another airline and tell them what happened? They don't give a shit. He said, well, you can't get here for the show. I said, I know. I'm going home. And I went home, and I played golf. It's not my fault they screw up.
Well, I got a question here, Honky. I gotta know.
Back okay, which one?
Well, here.
You promised you wouldn't ask that question.
Oh yeah. Well, you know, I'm not. Hey, I'm not asking that one. That's yeah. I'm not a fun boy.
Yeah, you wanted to talk about my manhood.
Brady don't do that. I'm not a fun boy. But I want to ask you a question about the Intercontinental Heavyweight Championship that you sold back in the day. You were in a feud with Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Yeah.
Or, you know, Disciple, you know, man with no name.
Yeah.
And you were going to wrestle him at SummerSlam, and all of a sudden the match was changed, and you were going to, you know, go up against Warrior. Now, why was the match changed originally between you and Beefcake? I mean, did something happen backstage there, and that's the reason they changed, or was the plan all along for you to drop the belt to Warrior?
It was all along. Beefer was never considered to be in that, and what they did, how they got out of that was, if you guys remember, they had Outlaw Ron Bass take the spur off and run it across Beefcake's head, and Beefcake bled the chicken blood, and
right.
What people say, and then Beefcake was injured and then could not be at SummerSlam. But the whole setup with the Warrior and everything had come, I'm thinking six months ahead of time. And only myself, Jimmy Hart, Vince, Pat, and Vince's closest guys that he confided in, and Warrior knew anything about that until it was just going to happen.
Okay, and I've heard you say in other interviews that, you know, you were on top as the Intercontinental Champion. I mean, you know, I guess you guys had an A crew or B crew or something like that in back in the day. And
yeah.
you would be main eventing Towns as the Intercontinental Champion. So why is it that, I mean, I know you know, said this before in other interviews that it was never in the plans. But do you wish you would have had a run with Hogan, you know, champion versus champion?
Oh, gosh. I mean, listen, the run with Hogan, that was $10,000 a day.
Wow.
That, I mean, we were doing nine shows a week. That's 90 grand.
Yeah.
that's big bread, brother. Hey, brother. I don't give a shit how you cut it. If you had 6 months with Hogan, and let's say it didn't do 90. Let's say it did $60,000 a week times 9 months. You are 6 months. You guys do the math. That's retirement money, man. And that's the kind of money that was floating around. But if you were making, if you make $10,000 for Hogan to drop the leg, Hogan made 15. He might have made 20.
Wow.
That money was huge. And people talk about, well, Stone Cold outdrew Hogan, and Stone Cold this, and John Cena this. Look, Hogan was making $20,000 a day sometimes. He was making $100,000 every 3 days. My God, and the only way you could get a piece of merchandise was you had to buy it from the magazine or you had to go to the arena to get it. If they had opened up that merchandise on Hogan to Kmart, Walmarts, Target stores all over the world like they did when Stone Cold came along, it's incredible what the money Hogan would have made.
So you don't agree with you know a lot of people's sentiment that Austin was you know, made more money than Hogan.
He might have made more money the way that it was structured, but given the same limitations, he wouldn't have came close. No.
Wow. So I guess my next question is going to be is that, you know, after the loss of the Warrior, you had some matches with him after that, and you never got the Intercontinental Championship belt back. They put you in a tag team with Greg Valentine. You were known as Rhythm and Blues. And
well, I call it Rhythm and Snooze.
I can agree with that because you guys were never
he was sleeping, and I was trying to get the tag team to, you know, let's generate some income here and try to get over.
Yeah. Yeah, you guys never won the tag team championship, and after that...
We were set to get them. We were set
to
win the belts. We were set to win the belts from the Hart Foundation until the Road Warriors signed their deal. Once they signed, that was it. We went behind the eight ball, and we were pretty much finished.
Yeah, and then after that, I mean, you did some independent stuff, and then you showed up at WCW.
Yeah. Thinking it... Because I knew they were throwing money around there like crazy.
Right.
And as Hogan said, it was a 24-hour ATM machine. But Eric Bischoff did not like me, and I don't know why. I've never met the guy before. He said so in the very first meeting. And from there, I kind of hung around for 3 months without a contract. And after that, I said, to heck with this.
What is your overall opinion of Eric Bischoff? So you said that Bischoff... You know, had never met you, but he didn't like you. And I've heard that, you know, I mean, you know, he said the same thing about Lex Luger, but he had previous interaction with Luger. What's the beef there, and have you guys actually kind of mended fences?
Never talked to him since then. Have not, had no contact with him at all. Really don't even care. Could care less, because, first of all, you always put business first, not your personal feelings. And especially if you're dealing with someone else's money, like he was dealing with Ted Turner's money. Now, if it was Eric's money completely, it was his bankroll, like it's Vince's money, and if Vince doesn't like someone, he doesn't want to put them on TV, and he doesn't want to hire them, that's his call. But when you're using other people's money, you should have the other person's part of the business involved in your decision also, not be personal. There's been guys that I literally could not stand to be in the ring with. I didn't want to be in a locker room with them. I damn sure didn't want to ride on the airplanes with them. I didn't want to see them every morning. But it was business, and it didn't matter. You know, you don't have to love the person that you work with or that you work for.
That's a perfect segue into my next question. How are things with you and Jerry Lawler?
I haven't seen Jerry since one of the Wizard Worlds in Chicago a couple years ago. Even when I went back and did the Raw thing in Buffalo, I didn't see him the whole time at all. So, you know, it is what it is, and I don't see him. He don't see me. So we don't converse at all. We have no conversations.
What's the heat there, though? I mean, between each other. I mean, I've heard a story about, you know, it was some kind of payoff or something like that.
It goes way, way, way further back than that. But there again, you know, I was taking it more personal, and maybe he took it more personal. But you know, it's all been water under the bridge now, and everything, and has nothing to do with nothing. You know, he can't control me making a living. I can't control him making one, so it doesn't matter. It's a non-issue.
Do you have any relationship with Brian Christopher?
No, not at all. I've seen Brian once since he left WWE a couple of years ago, and that was it. And there was reports by a promoter who doesn't like me of all sorts of nasty things that happened, which other people were there, and they dispute that, so I don't care. Listen, there's been a lot of shit said about me, and I don't get mad about it. I don't care. Listen, call me anything you want. Just give me a call. Make sure you got some money. And it's cash. I don't take checks. And I don't fly on bullshit airlines. And I don't take a 10-hour plane ride to get to L.A. when it's only 40 minutes.
What is your thoughts on, you know, Vince is kind of winding things down a little bit. More and more power is now going to Triple H and Stephanie McMahon. Of course, you know them over the years. I just wonder what your thoughts on the power structure changing in WWE.
I was never around Stephanie. She was in college, and of course, a younger kid. Maybe she wasn't even in college when, and I only saw her, met her once in reality that I even remember, and that was the WrestleMania 13 in Chicago. Other than that, I was never around her at all, so I don't know her. Don't know anything about her. Triple H, I was around with Kowalski when he was there because I worked a lot with Kowalski, and he was a trainee and working there. Always a nice, pleasant fellow. I was around him in WCW for that short period of time where he wasn't being used any better than I was, and he wasn't happy, same as I was. That's been it. And every time I've seen him since, it's always been a cordial, but there's not a real personal relationship there at all. As far as Vince stepping back out of the thing, the only reason Vince has taken a little bit of a back seat I can understand is there's more things to running the company now than it was 5 years ago. There's more things to running that company than it was 1 year ago. So as much as Vince wants to be the hands-on guy and the go-to guy, now mind you, every real major decision I think he sits in on and knows about. But the day-to-day operations, he just can't do it all. It's too big. It's too big. And unless you guys go backstage or you see them roll into town, it's bigger than a Rolling Stones concert.
Did you ever have any relationship with Shane McMahon?
No, he wouldn't. Just a little bit when I was back doing some commentary and doing the rockabilly thing, he was a tremendous talent in the ring. Now, this kid impressed me. He would do everything. And another nice guy. He worked his way through. When I was there, and he would be off from school in the summers, he was on the ring crew. And at that time, he wasn't even the driver. He had to tote the ring. And I would see him greasy and dirty, setting the ring up and doing all the grunt work. He worked his way through the ranks, and he did very, very well. And he's a first-class gentleman, nice guy.
Wow.
I guess while we're just dropping names, any relationship or opinion of Vince Russo?
Oh, gosh, I've been very opinionated on Vince Russo, as much as Jimmy Cornette. I don't know where, here's the thing, and I wasn't around Vince Russo very much at all, other than when I was back doing the commentary and doing the wrong thing. I don't understand is how this guy who was he had some kind of a video shop over on Long Island or somewhere, and had a little radio show. Then all of a sudden, he gets hired to write the magazine. Now this guy's an expert on professional wrestling. I do not understand how he became an expert. That one I do not know. So, with that, and now that he's a born again Christian or something, God bless him.
Okay, one more name I want to throw out to you, Jesse Ventura. I wonder what your thoughts on him. The libertarian move. He's got his own internet show. He was doing the conspiracy theories. Kind of thoughts on what Jesse Ventura is up to doing these days?
You know, I really don't know. He had a book signing here in Mesa a few years ago when he was fairly, he was pretty hot. You know, Larry King was having him on all the time. I said, well, heck, I'll drop in. It's only a couple blocks away. I'll go down and say hello because, as far as I knew, we had a, Jesse and I were always good relationship. And in fact, Jesse was the guy that called me to come to WCW and put Flair on the phone because they were in a hotel room together. And that's how that all happened. And then I go down there and I said, hey, man, how's everything going? He said, I can't talk right now, brother. I got to do this interview. I'm sorry. I'll see you later. Later never came. I just went home. I said, okay, that's it. But Jesse has become, Jesse's Jesse. Let's put it that way. What you see on that, the conspiracy theory, and I watched it a couple times just out of curiosity, that's Jesse. That's him. I mean, that's him. And he's, you know what he's done? He's taken something that he made a joke out of, which was Jesse the Body Ventura and all this and everything, and he's made it into a worldwide name. He can never be bigger than Hogan. That bothers him. Sorry, Jesse.
And that was a shoot.
As we wrap with you, Honky, do you have any regrets on your career looking back? Anything you wish you could do over or change, you know, looking back at your career?
Okay. I could have been a little bit more politically correct, even on this show.
Well, that'd be boring.
Other than you know, being sometimes a real hothead and wondering, well, why are you doing this? You know, sometimes a guy deserves an answer, but then again, it's like I want the truth, and well, just tell me I can't handle the truth. Well, I can handle the truth, but it's such a nonsense business, and it started out that way, and I always thought if I worked hard and did everything I was supposed to, I would always be treated fairly and treated right, and I saw in the very beginning that was not the case. That was not the case, because I had been a school teacher, and if you're a school teacher and a coach, and you coach good and you teach good, you get rehired, and you'll keep getting rehired, and you'll keep getting hired and hired and hired until you retire. Not the way in the wrestling business. Who is great today can be in the toilet tomorrow. That's and with no explanation. And that's just how it works. What's the sad thing is this. I see these kids now, they go on the internet and they say, they get cut from WWF and WWE and they say, I lived my dream. I did what I wanted to. It was the best 1 year of my life. The best 1 year? That was your dream, to just be there for 1 year? My dream is to be there now. My dream is to be there till the day I die. I don't understand someone who lives a dream for like, yes, I lived my dream for 2 years. I was in the WWE. I got to be on Monday Night Raw. Oh, please. Come on.
And lastly, Honky, is there going to be a book someday? Are you working on a book?
No. No one would believe it. There, half the stuff I told you today, people are going to think I'm full of shit on. So, you know, they're not going to believe it anyway. I mean, it's too bizarre. It really is. And the books that's out there, especially if WWE does them, it's all WWE content. And I have stories from when I started and back years ago and places like Malden, Missouri, and doing that, and then finally going and working for Jarrett and Lawler and the Tupelo concession stand and how it all came about, things like that, that it would be interesting to people. And plus, that 10 or 12 years of my career, God bless YouTube. People can finally look back and say, hey, that guy actually wrestled sometime. He was pretty good in the ring. He wasn't just a cartoon act. Look, we were all cartoon acts in WWE.
True.
I mean, that's just the way it was. Right. WWE's an entertainment company, and that's how it was. Actually, professional wrestling is entertainment anyway. And for us to go out, and we used to beat each other up and have black eyes and go on TV, and knowing all the time, we didn't really beat each other up. Although I have been beat up before.
Plug up your upcoming shows, social media, anything you want to put over here at the end of the interview.
Well, everyone knows how to find me. I'm not hard to find. I can tell you that. That's why I don't hide from anything. Of course, we don't do a whole lot with the website. It's all Twitter now. Official HTM on Twitter and my real name, Roy Wayne Ferris, on Facebook. And other than that, I'm going over to Orangeburg, Kentucky this coming weekend for a Comic-Con again. It's the first ever in Orangeburg. It should be a great show. After that, I've got Tucson Comic-Con coming up. then a couple of more, and then wind it. I've got the big one in Steel City in Pittsburgh that's coming first week of December. Then after that, you know, it's ho-ho time, and hope somebody brings something for Christmas, you know, other than a bag of switches with a couple of Steely Dans. Somebody's well, laughing about that Steely Dan. Now, all the kids are going to have to go research that. There was a band, there was a name of a band called Steely Dan.
Yep.
And I didn't
remember.
I didn't know what a Steely Dan was until Jimmy Hart told me. it's for those kids that do stuff in their mama's basement.
Right. There you go. Well, Honky, I'm honored we finally got a chance to hook up. I've been meaning to, you know, do a podcast with you, an interview for so long. It's a great honor to finally talk to you. The greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time.
Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion.
Heavyweight Champion of all time. You guys do a great, you have a great show, and I'm glad to be part of it. And I go on your website. After this is over, I'll probably go on again. I go on 2-3 times a day just to check the, like I said, legitimate internet news. The other sites are like, they make, I don't know how they make that shit up, but you guys do legitimate news and things of that nature, and it's a pleasure to talk to someone who has some real insight into the business other than just wanting some fascinating stories. Thank you so much.